Hey y'all, my name is Prashant Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing a passage walkthrough in the MCAT Psych-So section. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on this passage, but today we're going to be going more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I take on this section. Let's get it. All right, great. So I've gone ahead and put the passage we're going through on the left and the questions on the right. So feel free to take a moment and pause the video and come back to us. If not, let's get right into talking strategy. For me, I like to maintain the same strategy regardless of what passage I'm working on. This gives me something to ground me. Whether the passage is super easy or super hard, I know I always have something to come back to. And this dramatically boosts my confidence going into test day, which is huge. For me, the strategy looks like read a paragraph, write a quick 3 to 5 word summary, go on to the next paragraph, same thing, and on and on and on. Doing this provides accountability at the end of each paragraph, making sure I understand exactly what's going on in my own words before progressing on to the next. At the end of the day, as long as I don't have to reread a passage, that saves a lot of time, right? If I only have to reread a paragraph, instead if I don't understand it, saves a tremendous amount of time comparatively. So with that, let's get right into this passage. CRISPR-Cas9 technology has the potential to edit the genetic code of humans. As a result, several ethical considerations have arisen. For example, is it ethical to edit the genome of a human embryo? A group of scientists are chosen for a committee to evaluate the ethical considerations of CRISPR-Cas9 technology. Before attending the meeting, all the scientists are across the belief that the technology has tremendous potential benefits as an investigative tool, but are extremely cautious and wary of widespread use of the technology in clinical settings. All right, so the question I always ask myself is what's going on, right? And I want to put this in my own words, abbreviations, any sort of mnemonics, whatever I need to help me understand it. No one else is going to be reading this other than you. So use symbols, use abbreviations, save time. So here, I'm gonna write CRISPR-Cas9, abbreviated, and then I'm gonna say ethics, and then I'm gonna point to scientists, right? Because the scientists are judging this. Awesome. So while it might not make sense, all I'm saying is that we have CRISPR-Cas9, we're looking at the ethics, and we're doing that via the scientists. All right, so now we'll go on to paragraph 2. The scientists are split into two groups, and each group is to come up with a scientific policy recommendation. Before discussing a new policy recommendation, Group 1 is shown a video that graphically displays the dangers of genome editing. Group 1 does not have a time limit to come to a decision. On the other hand, Group 2 is shown a video from the President of the United States emphasizing the speed with which they must arrive at a decision, and they are told to have 1 hour to arrive at a decision. Alright, again, what is happening? Briefly. So here, we have an experimental setup sort of thing. Experiment, group 1 and group 2. 1, infinite time. 2, limited time. Increased pressure, right? Comparatively. So something quick, simple, nothing too crazy. And so with that, we have a good summary of this first three paragraphs, and now we're on to our third. The evening following the exercise, the groups are asked to present their findings. Group 1 presents a policy entirely denouncing the CRISPR-Cas9 technology and states that potential negatives significantly outweigh the positives. Group 2, on the other hand, presents an uncreative policy that states regulatory limitations should be only created as problems rise. Alright, again, so what is happening? So, we're going to write outcomes, right, of this. And group 1 says negatives significantly are outweighing the positives, right? So X, CRISPR-Cas9. And so 2 is saying what? 2 is saying uncreative reflex response or something like that, right? So something quick, simple that makes sense to you. I'm separating it like this where I have group 1 and then there, and group 2 solutions going there. And so with that, we're ready to go on to our questions. We have a good understanding of what's happening. So let's go on to question number 1. Which of the following best describes how Group 1 arrived at his policy recommendation? Is it A, social loafing, B, bystander effect, C, groupthink, or D, group polarization? All right, so right away, before we get into questions, I want to make sure you understand one thing, and that is to understand every single term in these answer choices, not just the correct answer choice. The AMC pulls from a group of words that will be repetitively used over your practice tests, over your QPACs, and over practice questions. And so by understanding every term on there, you're limiting the pool of terms that you don't know. So let's make sure as we go through these terms, we understand every detail of what they mean. All right, so group one is arriving at his policy recommendation with infinite time, low stress, and then they come to it, negative being much, much greater than positive, okay? And so what does that mean? If group one is coming to a conclusion that is significantly more negative than positive, when what? When all the scientists believe that technology has tremendous potential benefits as an investigative tool, but are extremely cautious and wary of widespread use, right? So that's like the precursor. They start all as this like wary and cautious people, but they believe it has a lot of powers. But then group one presents a policy entirely denouncing. So we have a transition from good plus bad to bad, right? That's the big transition that's occurring. And so what does that mean, right? And we'll go through term by term to see if they apply and if that makes sense. All right, is it A, social loafing? No. What does social loafing mean? Social loafing means when you're in a group setting, your group members start to slack, right? An individual might start to slack because they see all the work being done around them, and so they are doing less work than is needed in the group. B, bystander effect. This doesn't really make sense in the context of this. Bystander effect means that as we have more and more people on sort of outside watching an incident, no one's going to want to respond to this incident because they think someone else will jump in. So right away we can eliminate A and B. Now we're down to C, groupthink, and D, group polarization. What is the difference between these terms? Well, groupthink is the idea of we're coming to some sort of conclusion. It's not going to be a very like nuanced or detailed solution. It's just going to be a solution that's meant to decrease conflict between people. It's sort of this path of least resistance of a solution. Group polarization, however, is detailing the idea that, oh, there might be some people who believe pro and some people against, but at the end of the day, they'll come to one side of that and be an extreme point of view on that. So let's say we start here, like we start in this area, right? On a, like a line. We sort of have like people in this area. Once they discuss, they will end up all the way over here, for example, or all the way over here. They're gonna end up on these extreme outlying positions. And so with that, we should see that this aligns really well with group one, in that they are starting at this sort of medium position and ending up at this drastic position. And that's a sign of group polarization. Groupthink doesn't exactly work here because that is not really talking about path of least resistance or coming up with solutions just for harmony's sake. So we can eliminate C, and we're on to question number two. All right, question number two. Which of the following best describes how group two arrived at its policy recommendation? Is it A, social loafing, B, bystander effect, C, groupthink, or D, group polarization? All right, so these are the same answer choices as the first question, so we don't need to go into them in depth. But what I do want to note is that these are the answer choices that you will see, right? These are the answer choices that will come up over and over again, these terms. And so group two is starting with that same sort of set of scientists, but then presenting an uncreative policy that states regulatory limitations should only be created as problems arise. So the key word I want you to focus in is uncreative, right? It's creating this uncreative policy, something that's like not well thought out or not well detailed, that's continuing with a certain belief as opposed to becoming more and more extreme. And so this is the distinction between C versus D, right? D, we come out with an extreme position at the end of the day. C, groupthink, is more about maintaining harmony. Everyone's thinking in the same mindset. So we can eliminate D, and for the same reasons as we mentioned in one, this isn't social loafing or bystander effect. This isn't someone putting in less effort when they're in a group setting or someone not interacting because they're in a group setting with more and more people. So we can eliminate A, B, and D, and we're on to D. For that question, I would really try to use the process of elimination, right? Even if you don't know the difference between groupthink and group polarization off the top of your head, you can eliminate A and B. You can then decide between D because to eliminate D because there's no extreme position at the end of the day. All right, finally, all right, we're on to question number three. A scientist initially rejects the policy recommendation in group one, but agrees after she realizes that she is outnumbered. This is an example of A, socialization, B, obedience, C, conformity, D, social facilitation. All right, four new terms. We need to know every single one of these terms and what they mean. All right, so what is the answer to the choice that's standing out to us, right? Some of these terms are stuff that we've dealt with in our ordinary life and understanding. So let's start with the most common one, right? Obedience. Obedience is talking about sort of deference to a higher authority, okay? So someone in power is sort of has all the power and you're looking up to them and you're trying to obey them. So in this case, a scientist initially rejects and then realizes that she's outnumbered. She's not really talking about some sort of higher power that's overpowering her in a decision-making process. So we can eliminate B. All right, let's go on to conformity. Conformity is an idea that we constantly understand, right? We understand conformity in the ideas of peer pressure or whatever, right? An individual deciding to change a course of action just because a majority or a larger group of people believe in that, a different action. And so C is seeming like our best answer here for now. But let's go through socialization and social facilitation to understand what they mean. What is socialization? It's the idea of an individual or a generation joining into a culture or a group by adopting the sort of knowledge, the attitudes, the practices, the traditions, all of that in order to become a part of the culture. So this is sort of like coalescing with culture or generation, right? So we will socialize to a new country, socialize to a new group of people, whatever. All right, so we can eliminate A because that doesn't make sense in this context. D, social facilitation, is how actions occur when we're in the presence of other people, right? And so there's two things I want you to remember from social facilitation, and that's whether you have a simple task or a complex task. A simple task, you'll go faster / perform better in front of people, okay? So if it's something simple and something you've practiced over and over again, you're gonna perform it better when you're in front of people. A complex task is the opposite. You're gonna perform worse in front of people, right? Because it's a little more complicated, a little more high pressure, something you might not have practiced over and over again. A complex task is going to be harder to perform in front of people. So idea is social facilitation is how we perform different tasks in front of different numbers of people. And so with that, we've picked C and we're on to our final question. Which of the following is not an agent of socialization? Is it A, media, B, peers, C, hunger, or D, family? Okay, so this is a standalone question. We don't even need to look at the answer, the passage. But that requires us to understand what is an agent of socialization. So we described what socialization is in this previous question. But what influences that? What is an agent of socialization? Well, we have three things that I want you to focus in on. One, people. Right? People in your life can affect socialization. Two, institutions. Or three, traditions. Right? So this spells out pit. So that's my little mnemonic to help me remember. A pit of socialization. But the idea is, if they fall into these three categories, they're going to be an agent of socialization. And so right away, we can draw lines and sort of figure out what matches what, right? So we see media is an institution. Media, religion, all of these types of groups are institutions. Peers are people, right? Just the people you work with, people you study with, whatever. Hunger doesn't really have a place in here. It's not a people, it's not an institution or a tradition. So we can eliminate C as R, not an agent of socialization, and check out D, family. And family also falls into this people as well as an institution part of it, right? And so all three of these other answers fall into being agents of socialization, and hunger does not. And with that, we're 4 for 4. Great work. All right, great work, team. Crushed another psych-soc passage. Kudos for you for getting it done. Really want to emphasize understanding and memorizing every single one of those answer choices. The concepts around them are super important, will come up over and over again. So make sure you memorize and understand exactly what are going on in those answer choices so you broaden your knowledge and can get that 132 you really want on this section. If you like this video, give us a like and subscribe to our channel and comment exactly what you're looking forward to in our next videos. Check out our 528 strategy series from Vikram. Really has tips and more in-depth explanations on how to maximize your score with the same strategies I'm mentioning here. And finally, click the link in our bio to sign up for our MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any studying before test day. Happy studying, and let's get it.